Senators and ladies and gentlemen, it is my great honor to introduce to you the commander of the 10th Mountain Division, New York's own, Major General Walter Piatt. General?
Thank you very much. Good morning, and thank you for this incredible welcome to this beautiful capital in the great Empire State. And thank you again for honoring this division on the 7th Fort Drum and 10th Mountain Division Day. Majority Leader John Flanagan, Independent Democratic Conference Leader Jeff Klein, Democratic Conference Leader Andrea Stewart Cousins, and our very own Senator Patty Ritchie and her staff and all your staffs, and for all of you, for your service in and out of uniform and for what you do in this chamber every day. It's to protect these institutions and why we fight. And Senator, you're right, it's for that next generation as well. The Sergeant Major will be here afterwards to take their recruiting statement, so we'll be ready. But this is what we do, and we can't say thank you enough to our very own and special patriot, to the 10th Mountain Division, Senator Ritchie. Her dedication to our post, its soldiers and our families, it humbles us all, inspires us every day, and motivates us to continue to serve. I tell everyone where I go that North Country is the best military community in our Army. I tell it that way because on several occasions, when my son was playing high school sports for the Carthage Comets, he received something in the mail from Senator Ritchie, a photo from a newspaper, a local newspaper, showing a sport highlight saying, "I saw something special about you, and I wanted to send this to you." That doesn't happen everywhere, and it didn't happen because of my rank. It happened because my son was Josh Piatt, and he was a member of a school district that just happened to have military kids in it. He holds that on his wall today. Still, so thank you, Senator. I appreciate you all welcoming us a little bit early this year because, as mentioned, the division headquarters begins our deployment to Iraq. We start heading out this week. We will complete our deployment by early March. And then by mid-March, I will assume the duties of the Coalition Force Joint Land Component Commander in Iraq. We know that this deployment comes at a very critical time. We deployed there in January for 2 weeks. And you're right, it was a little bit warm there, Senator. And folks who were flying the helicopters, it was about 40 degrees. And they were cold. They were from Oklahoma, and they said, "We need to turn on the heat for the general and the sergeant major in the back." Sergeant major reminded them, "Hey, we're the 10th Mountain Division. This is kind of hot, so please don't turn the heat on. We'll take the air conditioning." But we do deserts so well. We go where we're told. And we fight where we go, and we win where we fight. That is the 10th Mountain Division. But this deployment comes at a critical time. It comes at a critical time now that Iraqi people now have hope. There's a real sense of joy in Baghdad because of this last victory they achieved against the Islamic State. And it was a victory. The Islamic State invaded Iraq and pushed forward as the Iraqi army had to flee through the violence that was coming. They were at the gates of Baghdad. Iraq itself was almost overthrown. It was the Iraqi security forces and the Iraqi people that stood up for this. They were enabled by a mighty coalition, and they will continue to get our support. But it was the Iraqi soldiers that went door to door, block by block in Mosul to defeat the most ruthless enemy this world has seen. And though it was a victory for the people of Iraq, this enemy is a global threat, and this was a victory for the world. Folks often ask, what are they doing about their own security? The real question is, what have they done for world security? They defeated ISIS in Iraq and in Syria. They defeated their caliphate. Now we must complete the destruction of this terror group, and that's what the 10th Mountain Division will now deploy to go and do. Our 3rd Brigade, our Patriot Brigade from Fort Polk, Louisiana, has been over there since last September. They moved into country in September, and they immediately went where the enemy was, providing critical fire support, intelligence support, and helped defeat the remnants of ISIS in Mosul and pursued it throughout Hawija and now the Anbar Valley all the way to the border of Syria. The enemy is defeated as a conventional threat, but he's not destroyed. The time is now, and he remains ever vigilant. And October 1st, we lost a soldier in Iraq, Specialist Alex Misseldine. He was attacked by an improvised explosive device just outside of Salah Adin Operations Center. I had the honor of presiding over his funeral in Tyler, Texas. We presided down a 10-mile convoy through a town where everybody stopped their cars and put their hands on the heart for this fallen hero. All Alex wanted to do was serve his country. All he wanted to do was serve his unit in combat. He fought to earn his spot on that deployment. It cost him his life and his parents their only son. But as his father said to me, this is the cost of our freedom, and I hope Alex's sacrifice will inspire the unit and this division to continue to serve. And it certainly does. When I was here in this chamber last May, I told you about what the units in the 10th Mountain Division were doing. Our Combat Aviation Brigade deployed to Eastern Europe, assuring our allies, deterring our adversaries, building up military power in a NATO alliance where we have seen great reduction and increased threats from adversaries. They returned just in time for Thanksgiving, but now they are flying again in UAO helicopters over the North Country as they get ready for whatever mission is next. We deployed one of their Apache battalions to the Republic of Korea for a 9-month deployment at a time that is absolutely critical that we have military presence forward to deter adversaries on the Korean Peninsula. And it was right about that time in the fall that hurricanes brought devastation to the doorstep for thousands of American citizens. What called from our 10th Mountain Division was a very specialized unit, the 510th Human Resource Company. They deployed no notice to Texas. And as soon as they came back from supporting Hurricane Harvey, they were once again called to go to Puerto Rico to support the aftermath of Hurricane Maria. They didn't know where they were going to stay. They had a rucksack, but all of them said, now we get to go help our own citizens. A young lieutenant led the deployment to Puerto Rico. Her husband, also in the 10th Mountain Division, was out on exercises doing a live fire. She was unable to call them. But she got on that plane. She did her job. And because of that specialized unit, many, many folks that were there to help with the reconstruction and help with the devastation were able to follow through, get in country, and go to where they needed to go. They did it for the honor to help our fellow Americans. In September, we also sent 1st Battalion, 87th Infantry Regiment to Afghanistan and to Cameroon, Africa, on a deployment that came with almost no notice. Our nation called, just giving us weeks to get this regiment ready. And they were. They are deployed to Afghanistan today. They are helping specialized units and special operations forces all around the country, taking the fight to the enemy and enabling Afghan security forces to become ready. And also, our 548th Combat Sustainment Brigade returned home from a successful deployment in the Middle East just before Christmas, and it came down to the wire. We didn't know if we were going to get them back. They supported from Kuwait, but they were really everywhere. All the way to Syria, we had soldiers from the 10th Mountain Division supporting our forces in the fight, and they did a marvelous job. Today, we have over 4,000 soldiers deployed to 17 different countries around the world, Korea, many countries in Africa, Iraq, Afghanistan, and many more. We say all the time, the 10th Mountain Patch, the sun never sets on our patch. We are stationed in Fort Drum, New York, but we go everywhere, and we're always there. And if all that coming and going didn't keep us busy enough, we lean forward on a campaign to once again open our great post, which I so proudly call a nature preserve, that we just happen to be allowed to train soldiers on. We open our post to our surrounding communities. Our post is beautiful and shares an awesome history with the rest of Northern New York. But in the past 16 years of war and all the security requirements that came with that, we began to build up walls, real and metaphorical. That question about that, we needed to know, We needed to maintain security, there's no question. But we did not need to be divided from the community that supports us so well. In June, we opened up the post to more than 10,000 soldiers, families, and community members to host country music star Trace Atkins for a free concert. We'll do that again this year. Don't know who the artist is going to be, but it'll be big. And just a month later, after the tragic in-line-of-duty death of local hero Trooper Joel Davis, we joined forces with the New York State Troopers to hold his funeral on Fort Drum. After his death, we, like so many other organizations, offered what assistance we could provide. In less than a week, a team of troopers and Fort Drum employees organized a memorial tribute that welcomed close to 4,000 mourners onto our post. It was an incredible honor to be part of remembering so great a man. I will never forget Trooper Joel Davis. He was a hero that ran to meet danger without hesitation. Together we mourn his loss, but we will forever honor his life. His service will never be forgotten. Then in September and December, we opened our post to tours of the Luray Mansion, the ancestral home of the man thought to be the founding father of upstate New York. In November, we brought more than 400 community members, many of them with personal connections to the sites of villages that were dissolved during the expansion of Fort Drum in the 1940s. After that event, I received a letter from one of the participants telling me, and I quote her now, "The Army's obvious concern for the environment has allayed concerns I had harbored for many years previous. As a result of the friendly atmosphere I encountered on Monday, I no longer perceive the installation as foreign territory that must be approached with caution," unquote. In recognizing the past, we are doing great work in solidifying the future of Fort Drum. This perhaps is not the most obvious route to staying relevant for the next 30 years, but I argue it's one of the most effective. And we also started new traditions, hosting the first ever all-Army hockey team for their inaugural game against the Canadian hockey team. And against all odds, we won. And perhaps an even bigger win came that night when we packed the house. There wasn't an empty seat in the Watertown Municipal Arena. Soldiers, their family members, and the community showed up in force to cheer their team on. And with that warm reception on a very cold night, Watertown earned its spot forever as the home ice for Army hockey. And we also spent a lot of time working with communities, talking about how our training needs are expanding, and our enemies gain the ability to defeat us from further and further away. The way we are fighting wars now is changing, and our training has to change with it. We are now facing enemies that can attack us from further away. In many areas, our enemies have us outnumbered, outgunned, and outranged. This is unacceptable. We must be able to win our wars to protect our nations, which means we have to be able to defeat every adversary that poses a threat to our United States. And if we can win that war, we can certainly deter that war. But we need to train against the future fights, because our enemies are expanding these threats through air defense systems that are elaborate, that can deny the U.S. Air Force entry into certain spaces. They make it very difficult. It becomes now, again, a land fight. The call for the U.S. Army and the Army infantry is even more important now than it ever has been. But to be able to defeat that enemy, we've got to train against that, against greater standoff, utilizing manned and unmanned systems. We need to be able to train with Air Force and the New York Air National Guard so they can drop their precision munitions on Fort Drum for many years to come on platforms that exist today and many that aren't even invented yet. If we are properly to train our soldiers for what awaits them on the future battlefield, we must continue to train for that future. We must be prepared with methods not yet understood, with technology not yet invented, and doctrine not yet written. And this sort of training brings the idea to bear of all encroachment around our post into clear focus. The main topic of discussion this past year has been industrial wind turbines. Many on either side of the issue always ask me, what is Fort Drum's position? And I remind them strongly, Fort Drum is an advocate for positive growth in the North Country. We must do this together. We know that energy needs to be secure in our nation, and protecting that energy is part of our own national military strategy. We know that green energy is part of that solution, but we also know that if we plan together, we can do this smartly. We just want to be part of that process, and I thank all of you here for allowing us to be part of that process. We have been heard by our local communities and by New York State. Local municipalities and developers alike now are reaching out to us to be part of their planning, and New York State has made our input part of the Article 10 process. These are hard conversations to have, but as much is at stake. But you have my promise that I will always be transparent and work towards positive growth in the North Country that we all love so much. And I thank you all for your heartfelt considerations in these delicate matters. But it's true to form. This is the kind of support that we expect and we have seen from Albany time and time again. And so many things that are important to our soldiers, our families, and our Army, New York steps up to the plate all the time. You supported the Interstate Compact on Educational Opportunity for Military Children that addresses transitional issues encountered by military families like enrollment, placement, eligibility. And there's an example in the gallery today. My daughter, Jessica, went to four different high schools. As we moved here before her start of her senior year, guidance counselor from my local high school, Carthage High School, got her transcripts, made sure that she had the right classes, could graduate and apply on college on time. And I'm proud to say she received a college scholarship to Duquesne University and graduated in 3.5 years. That would not happen without your help. She would have had to take extra classes. Her college acceptance would have been delayed or maybe not have happened at all and maybe missed time. New York does it right. Now she's back here in Watertown working for the Chamber of Commerce, sitting right next to her boss, Callie Peck. So military kids do recognize that these bases are indeed their homes. You support our unique healthcare model through our support to the Fort Drum Health Planning Organization. The U.S. Army Surgeon General came to visit us twice, and she came in January, which makes her a friend of the 10th Mountain Division. She came to learn about our model and how unique it is. And she visited the facilities that we have off post. We don't have a hospital on our base that's unique to our military, but we rely on the support of 5 local hospitals and mainly the support from Samaritan Hospital, which I always fondly call Samaritan Army Hospital in Watertown, New York. It is a unique model, but it is a win-win for the New York State and for our soldiers. It's not just about access to health care. It's about military readiness. And for that, I say thank you, New York. The State University of New York supports soldiers and family members access to students' aid initiatives like the Excelsior Scholarship and access to state tuition rates. SUNY and New York State Energy Research Development Authority offer programs to retrain our soldiers who are leaving the service so that they can enter the workforce instead of the unemployment line. On behalf of all of us who strive to keep learning, I say thank you, New York. The New York State Police partner with our Department of Emergency Services for mutual aid on post training and event support. For all of us who sleep well at night, knowing we're safe, I say thank you, New York. You voted to support our military spouses with expedited licensing services with reduced fees for many career fields. For all of us who ask so very much from our spouses and are able to do so little and able to do so little to lessen the impacts on their careers. Thank you, New York. The New York State Department of Environmental Conservation, Region 6, is a steadfast partner in ensuring that our training requirements and sustaining our environment aren't at odds. For the many of us who are in awe of the nature preserve that is Fort Drum, we say thank you, New York. And for your continual investment in keeping Fort Drum as relevant in 30 years as it is today, through projects like the I-781 connector and the Route 26 overpass, linking our main post to our critical airfield, thank you, New York, for cementing our future. And thank you for the young men and women who have grown up in towns and cities throughout New York, left their hometowns to train and become soldiers in the United States Army. Some of those soldiers, as introduced, are here today. Soldiers like Sergeant Joseph Frank from Rome, who was told that the Army would be too hard for him, that he couldn't do it. When he earned the rank of non-commissioned officer, sergeant, it made him think about what else he could accomplish and how far his career in the profession of arms might take him. Others, like Specialist Hunter Bishop from Plattsburgh, answered the call to serve after being affected by the attacks of 9/11, and he wanted to make a difference. Soldiers like Sergeant Jonathan Ruiz could see the smoke from the towers of his school in Brooklyn before the teachers closed the window blinds. He didn't understand what was happening then, but he said that years later, that's what motivated him to enlist. For all those soldiers, I say thank you, New York. The coalition I will soon join in Iraq faces, as I said, a difficult mission. For wars do not end in peace, and the terrorists are still there. Although defeated militarily, they still pose a threat. We must continue with surgical precision, hunt down those who mean to threaten Iraq, Syria, and indeed our own United States. But we must also help stabilize the populations as they come back from the ruins of war to rebuild their country so that they can be an independent, free Iraq and a partner to the United States in the Middle East. On 12 May, one of our very first tasks will be to help provide the security for Iraq's elections again. So in all this time of crisis, they have not given up on those democratic ideals. And now the political fight that remains post-conflict is one that we will continue to assist and enable until they are secure in their country. But just as we did here years ago when the Army outgrew Madison Barracks in Sackett's Harbor, New York worked with us to find new areas to train in Pine Plains. When we outgrew that area, more than 500 families left their homes to keep us mission capable on the condition that we would respect and keep their cemeteries and preserve the environment. We keep those promises daily. Has this compromise always come easy? Of course not. But as I've learned on the battlefield, and as our shared history tells us, forcefully disabling the opposition solves only a fraction of the problem, whereas the energy and effort you put into relationships has the capacity to build a lasting peace. Thank you for living that lesson through legislation here in Albany and by the support you show our military members back in your home districts. New York is an incredible place to serve. Please keep our deployed soldiers in your thoughts and prayers in the coming year. We will assist in completing the destruction of ISIS in Iraq so that they can no longer threaten the world. And I want to make sure I will re-emphasize the open invitation that Senator Ritchie gave to you all. Be sure to come visit us in New York. Just dress warm and comfortable, because even in July, you're going to get cold, and you're darn sure going to get dirty when you come out and train with the infantry. But we love to show off our installation, and we love for folks to see how wonderful it is cared for the people of upstate New York. Thank you again for this opportunity. We are honored to be here today and a part of this great state every day. But know this, no matter what terror fights, no matter where we send, no matter what challenges we face, your 10th Mountain Division will accomplish the mission. No matter how difficult the job, no matter how dangerous the climb, we will not stop. We will keep moving until we all meet at the top. Ever upward, climb to glory. Thank you all very much.